Am I audible at the back? No? So, my talk is about powering WordPress with Docker. Has anyone here heard the word Docker? Has anyone here heard the word Docker? Okay, you won't be counted. Anyone else? Okay, so I'll start with an introduction. So I was interested in WordPress from college days. I mainly started by downloading the WordPress zip from wordpress.org, tried to make a website that was simply running more than I expect. Okay, so how many of you have faced the trouble of scaling up your website? Like, you suddenly get a lot of traffic and it gets down. Anyone? Okay, good. So I will try to talk about a tool called Docker, how it can help us scale the WordPress better. So this is a talk about Linux, containers, scaling traffic and all the black console stuff. So your mileage may vary, right? That's completely okay. I will try to talk less about Linux and more less about Chargers. So agenda for today. So the monolith word means hosting everything. You are hosting everything of your WordPress website on a single server. So we'll talk about pros and cons of a monolith hosting, where you host your database, WordPress files, a web server, everything on the single server. That's a monolith hosting. Then we'll talk about what is Docker, pros and cons of Docker, and what problem can Docker solve for WordPress community or the WordPress people, and beyond the WordPress to the production. I'll try to keep it a more of an introduction to every pieces, so you can go at home and just try the tools at your pace. So how does the current hosting look like? Monolith, shared VPS, dedicated cloud, right? Any one of these? You've taken a VM from DigitalOcean or AWS or anywhere, or a cPanel shared hosting, right? So how that architecture on the server side looks like? So if you are using a shared hosting, in the Linux side, what the cPanel does is it creates a directory from your username and hosts your file under that. You see public_html directory and all. So there you have folders where your WordPress files are there. And cPanel is running a web server which routes the incoming request to your files. And it serves a purpose. Those are very small traffic websites, right? It works. So that is what's called monolith hosting, where you host your database on the same side, everything is on that side. But when traffic gets more, or when you want to scale up, it becomes like a classroom without a monitor or teacher. Every student is doing, every website is doing whatever they want. They're consuming resources of your CPU, RAM and everything without your knowledge. Like, they consume it whatever they want. That's what shared hosting stands for, right? You have a higher resource server and you host 50 websites on a single server. What is the maximum number of sites have you hosted on a website? Mine is 40 on a Linux server. Anyone beyond that? How much?
60.
Nice. So that should be like typical classroom where you don't have a monitor and everyone is shouting. Every children is shouting, every site is doing whatever you want. You don't have a clue which site is using what resources, right? So pros and cons of monolith. Monolith is easy to manage. You have everything in a single box. So you have 50 websites, you have 50 directories. That's what cPanel looks like, right? You just go there, edit some files, easy. Even my uncle can use it, right? So it's cost effective. You don't have much of traffic, you don't have much of revenue, or you don't have much of value to gain from that website. You just host it. It's a friend's server, you just host it. Like she said, my friend helped with this. Bots are American, right? Just host my website. It's okay, it works fine. You hardly have 50 visitors a month. And it works, nothing else. Sharing is caring, You host your friend's website, and after a year, he gets like 1,000 visitors per day, and your server is blown. That's pro for sharing and caring, but it's a con as well. Right? Maybe more for Monolith. So what can be cons here? That's like a traffic jam. A single site can burn the whole app. Has anyone faced this issue where a single site has some security flaws or anything it has done and your all website has gone down? Quite a few. Mine as well. So one of my site just they just put password as password, and someone did a brute force on that site. The hacker installed a plugin on my website, on my web server. They got the access to the database. Everything got burned. Luckily, I had the backup of the site, so I was safe. But it can be a silly mistake which can burn your whole server, right? Deployment mess, security, and more. So, I mean, there can be many cons upon your use case. So, a fairy tale answer to all your problems. Dot. Well, not exactly. With couple of more tools if you can add. Kubernetes and OpenShift. So what exactly is the word Docker I am talking about? So Docker is an open source tool that helps you package application in containers. Have you seen the containers, the shipping containers?
Yes.
So it's a similar analogy. Has anyone heard the history why the containers were starting to use for the shipping? In 1980s or 1970s before, people used to ship stuff as it is on various size of products. I mean, if you were to ship a bag from US to India, they would ship it, like, they would pack it somewhere and just ship it. But the problem was they were not getting the exact match or the optimized size for the shipment. A bag, aap ek bag dal rahe ho aur it consume more size, then you don't have a size for putting another stuff in the same ship. So they started the idea of shipping everything in a unit size. So whatever stuff you want to sell, you send it in a container. So that becomes a standard. So the ship size and everything can become a standard size, and they can optimize the number of shipments can go. So the containers word is here in the Docker tool. It is derived from that analogy. So what is a container? A container is a lightweight application runtime environment. Okay, so Linux guys can understand more now. Acts like a OS but shares a kernel with it. How many of you heard the word kernel? And know it also. I see the hand going down. So, to simplify the word kernel, if you were to talk, if any of the application from your system was to talk to some hardware, it will go through the kernel. That's the simplest definition we can get. So, how many of you have deployed a virtual machine? Have also just heard of virtual machine? What are virtual machine? Yes. So, you are running a operating system. On top of it, you spin up another operating system, right? That's a virtual machine. So, a Docker container, it acts like it's giving you a virtual machine, but it shares the kernel with the base operating system. So this is the standard virtual machine architecture looks like. You have your infrastructure, you have your hypervisor, you have your guest OS. So in the guest OS, you are again running the kernel on top of your kernel. So that's overhead, right? And then you on top of it, you give your binaries and libraries, and then you deploy the application of the WordPress files. Talking in terms of WordPress, then you deploy your MySQL, WordPress, or Apache Nginx, whatever you deploy. Right? So this is what a standard VM would look like. So talking in about more containers. So containers are meant to be a standalone executable package, like we talk about the shipping containers. It's a standard thing you will ship. So in terms of So software deployment, it's a standard executable package you ship. I am not a Windows side, but the Windows.exe, you ship it like .exe, they work well. We just ship a EXE and it works, right? So a Docker container is meant to be an executable package in a sense, not a Windows EXE, but you ship it in a container and from, so from the developer's PC to the production environment, it is meant to be the same executable. So now comparing the virtual machine thing with the Docker context. So in the Docker, you have a single OS, and on top of it, you have the standard kernel. On top of it, you have the Docker Docker daemon running. Has anyone heard the daemon? Not the daemon, the Linux daemon. So this interesting. It works as a process. So your process is running on your operating system. Many of you might have seen that. So a Docker process, the Docker runs as a daemon process inside the machine you are trying to run. So in that process, what you do, you ship your whole application as a Docker container. Inside that container, you might have PHP application. You might have all the things you would have in a monolith environment, but that's not the optimal way to run a container. So what you do, you ship a WordPress container, you ship a MySQL container, and you ship a web server container. So what can be pros and cons of Docker? Easily ship and integrate. So it's like many of you might have heard that the guy running your development environment or maintaining the environment say it is not working. And developer would say it is working on my laptop. Yes? Many of you might have seen this. So Docker removes that dilemma, because in the production with the Docker, you will be running the same container which the developer is running on his system. So it's scalable. I'll show how it is scalable. It is secure. Why secure? Has anyone faced the problem PHP or hacking someone issues with WordPress gaining your files? Or has anyone faced a bug that some of your files get corrupted and you don't have a clue, right? I have seen it on my C panelizer. So there are many pros of a Docker, but it would be on the Linux side. What is the con? It's not quite easy to deploy your product. There is one more con. Half of the audience here doesn't get what I'm talking about. Right? So I will try to be more on the side what problems can Docker solve for WordPress. It will help you better utilize the resources. So this is the one which was the excitement for me to start learning Docker when I was deploying my WordPress site on Monolith. So Docker containers, or the Docker virtual machines, you can say. So Docker containers would run as a process inside your host system. So you can simply bound resources to each application. If you host everything, if you just put 50 folders in your /var /www, so those folders won't be able to bind resources that this site is meant to be only consume 500 MB of RAM. You won't be able to bind the application like that. But in terms of Docker, you will be able to bind each container or each set of container the resources you want. And this brings a lot of value when you have a shared environment. Your 50 sites, you can directly say, this is a friend website, I don't want to give it more than one CP. Even if I have 8 CP, right? It gives a admin control to bind the what are you running. So it gives you better deployment and architecture. So how many of you have got what I was telling till this point? More than I expected. So with the deployment and architecture, what I mean here is, so now you can ship your application as a container. And how you scale it? So how do you scale it in terms of virtual machine? If you are getting a traffic on a single virtual machine, you spin up another virtual machine and you put a load balancer, right? That's how you do in the regular hosting, like horizontal hosting, that's how you do. Or you give more resources to the accessing contents. But that won't be beyond like 32 CPU. What if you have got 20 lakh live users? What would you do? You would just scale to you would scale up to a 64 CPU VM, but then you would have to go to add up more VMs. But that would also have limitations. Why? Because you would have to put a separate database replica, your file system, your load balancer. You have to manually manage all your VMs, scale up, scale down. At that large, it's a lot of mess. Right? So with Docker, what you can simply do, the same thing which you did with the virtual machine. You can simply spin up another Docker container of the same image. So it would simply work like a virtual machine inside here. I mean, it would simply work the same way you did the virtual machine. So scale with PCs. You just add number of containers. It won't be an actual virtual machine. So can anyone guess what is the time to deploy a container? Okay, first, what was the average time to deploy a virtual machine? 1 minute? 5 minutes? How many? 1 minute? Yes. So the average time to deploy a Docker container is like from milliseconds to maximum a second. Right. So you can just spin up the containers on the go to scale up your environment within the second. So if you see, if you set the auto scale, if the same auto scaling was working on a virtual machine, you were losing traffic for until and unless when the new virtual machine comes up into the picture. You might have lost a lot of traffic. Which in terms of Docker, you just add up more containers, it would work in a second. So you don't lose up much of traffic. Security. So let's say your passwords got public and someone gained access to your file system via PHP or something or plugins. But unlike the previous example where you had all the sites, now you're just a container which acts like a OS. So you don't have access to actual host. It's a small dummy virtual machine running with the files. And even if your security was everything got public, he has nothing to do because there are 10,000 containers running and he would just have access to single container. So even if someone just got into a house with all the weapons and security flaws, he cannot just access your host. So you are safe. So beyond Docker and production. So how can you? So Docker is a process running, a daemon process running on a machine. But how do you exactly deploy this to production? I mentioned this was a pain point or the con for deploying Docker to the production. So there are a couple of tools that help Docker publish to the production, and those are Kubernetes and OpenShift. OpenShift is the one which I like to work on. It's a wrapper on Kubernetes. So you have seen the cPanel, right? What you do in the cPanel is you have a UI, you have your files, so it helps you automatically deploy on button clicks. You can do simply almost similar things with Kubernetes. You put your Git repository URL in the Kubernetes, you create a project, then it will spin a pod for you, and on the pods you can define a YAML file where you can say that this I want to put up three containers of Apache server, 5 containers of my WordPress file, and 3 containers of my database. Or if you are hitting, so let's say you have cached your WordPress files and you just need more of web servers to get so the incoming request, you just increase the number of Nginx or Apache server replicas. Database is already cached, so you can just play around number of containers with these tools. Or if you want, this is a problem I faced. I had a single virtual machine. Inside that I wanted to run 5 different Redis servers. Has anyone tried the Redis server? to cache the WordPress file.
Yes.
So I wanted to run the Redis servers for 5 of the sites, which were the same server. But what I didn't wanted was to install the Redis on the same server and let all the five caches on the same directory and on the same Redis server. That would be a lot of mess. And I don't know what cache is going. There might be an issue that one site's cache is being used by another site's cache. So in terms of Docker, what you can do, you can combine that in a container. So container is a single virtual machine. It doesn't know what the container sitting beside it is doing. It even doesn't know if there is a container sitting beside it. It acts like a complete virtual machine, almost. So with Kubernetes and OpenShift, you can play around a lot of around this. I know this was a technical side of thing, and half of you don't know what I was talking. But for developers, this can be a very helpful tool. And if you wanted to run beyond the virtual machine scale, Docker is a tool that can take you up. Any question or thoughts?
So basically, what you said was, to scale and resource utilization, to use Docker, right? But what if I start using VPSs for the same thing, like?
You can use VPS, definitely you can use.
And the same benefits I get by using VPS servers for inside without having to learn or use the Docker.
Yes, but in that thing, the context of or the functionality of Docker comes handy when you are looking things at scale. For example, if you have 5 websites, you can spin up for 5 VPS for them. But what if you have traffic for 5 of them on the same day? It gets a lot of mess. And Docker is not just spinning up virtual machine. It's about binding your application as executable to run inside a VPS. So if you were to deploy just Docker, you would create a new VPS, inside that you would run a Docker.
To run Docker on a VPS, what kind of resources VPS need?
So Docker itself adds very minimal resources. So the same deployment you can do with the Docker is a very light process, so it doesn't have its own resources to add, like what you do with a virtual machine. So you can simply run the same files and same database files as a do some minor changes running in a container. It doesn't need any extra resources to run. If your site was running on the 1 GB VPS, it can still run on 1 GB VPS, but with the extra ability to manage your container effectively. So you would have better architecture level, and you would have more precise knowledge about what's actually going on. If you have 10 sites, if you have 5 sites, what they are actually doing, you would have more control over it. It's binding application to the binding resources to the application level. We can get more of it.
Docker engine is there with whole container, right? Docker. In Docker architecture, that Docker engine is there with every container, right? And Docker engine also contains a separate shared library. Yeah. If one container uses a vulnerable or malicious library, it's if affected, then whole container is also affected.
So this goes to a different question. Where you say there is a bug in the VPS you are running. For example, you have deployed your site on an Ubuntu VM, and there is a security flaw in Ubuntu itself. Whole world is flawed. There was a recently similar flaw with the Intel CPUs, if you have heard.
Yeah.
So every single process on the world was affected. So in terms of Docker, I think your question is like, if there is a security flaw in Docker, each container is affected, right?
And Docker is a hypervisor.
Yes.
If your one virtual machine is affected, it's not affected
in another. So yes, if there is a security flaw inside that Docker container, no, it won't affect the other Docker container. So the concern of namespaces come into this thing. So each of the container or set of container have their different namespaces on the lower level of kernel. So if you log into a container and do what are the other container, what is the code way, you won't get anything. It's already quite a mature project now, and the security flaws are already almost now. So it won't, one container won't know anything about the different container. It won't even know if there is another container as well.
My second question, you were talking about your website is hacked and through a SQL injection and whole data is down, right? But you have a backup for your site. You restore again your backup, but still backup is also vulnerable to same vulnerability.
Yes.
How you call that?
So for that, the issue was on the production instance, there were SQL injection, a lot of stuff. So I went through the logs. I found that someone tried to brute force on that specific site. So I have kept the database automation which keeps the data every day. Every morning it keeps a check of that. It takes a backup of that site. So I spin up the new virtual machine, and from that I took the DB, and there was some more database recovery I had to do. So a lot of PHP and I had to play, which I didn't like.
In our hacker world, we always clean all the stuff, logs and everything. In this case, you can't read your previous logs. I'm also listed in top 50. I'm a Google hacker. Then I know about the whole log clean stuff. Then you never cover all your logs, and you never found your where is the vulnerability. It's best practice is your code review, your plugins and WordPress site. And also, there's a WP scans also available to find your bug in your plugin.
So what the only thing I found good to prevent this thing in future was to put a no allow in W on htaccess to XML rpc.php. That was the only thing I found good. So now I don't need to use APIs for the WordPress, so I just block for all the website there were. So that was the simplest thing I could do, being a non-PHP developer.
Thank you.
Yep.
What is the
basically, what I get, this
Docker is only for used. Manage the resources, like?
Not quite.
For the security reason, I think there are so many plugins which protect your WordPress website, basically. Only one tool is enough. I think WP security is enough for that. And the regular plugins on your website is quite okay. You maintain your website.
In terms of WordPress, what I meant here was security is not the basic or the essential thing that Docker provides. It's one of the perks that comes with the Docker. So, if you had a virtual machine, if you have two virtual machines, one of the virtual machines got hacked. Let's say your SSH password got public. Do you feel there is any chance that your another virtual machine's password would get affected? No, because you don't know if there is another virtual machine on that same host, right? So, for the security terms, I meant that the Docker container doesn't know if there is another Docker container. So even if the hacker gets access to your file system via PHP or something, he won't have access to another container that is running the same site, that is serving the traffic through the same VPS. It doesn't know if there is a container because the system is already combined or isolated via namespaces and the Docker security things. It is already isolated. So it doesn't know if there is a container.
One website can contain two containers.
It can run 10,000 containers.
Right, it depends on your website. Suppose, in that case, if a plugin is installed with the right intention, not with the wrong intention, it won't work. Why?
Because you are saying if your password is linked, okay, and he is installing a plugin with the wrong intention, and your database will be removed. With the right intention, it won't work. Because same thing, I want to install a plugin.
So, you was asking why, how will you install same plugin on 10,000 containers?
Yeah.
So that's why you do a git. So you use a git repository to or a file. There are more of architecture level things on OpenShift and Kubernetes to how to manage the same container across the production environment. What I was talking about is even if the single. So what you would do in that case, for example, there is a malicious plugin installed on the all 10,000 containers you have. And if a hacker is trying to send up, let's say XMRPC say kuch kar raha hai, and he gains file access, for example, then or some database access, for example, database might get affected. That's a correct question or the correct answer. But you would only have the process running on a single container. The other containers won't be running the same process. That's a WordPress level thing, and I'm not quite into the whole thing. But that's a different context, I think.
My question was that if my plugin works with the right condition, first of all, I want to enter my guest here. I'm using WordPress,
and I want to enter
my
data
to the right intention, and same thing I want to get the
data.
In the other hand, on the other hand, the hacker wants to do that. He wants to get the data without the password, with XMRPC or something else.
In both cases,
the blocker works.
Yes, blocker works.
So,
what is the need of blocker in that case?
The need of blocker is mainly at deploying containers at scale. I mean, it's more on the ops side. It is like if you were to do the same thing, if you have 10,000 or like say 1,000 VMs running, you won't be able to manage all of them the way more effectively you can do it with Docker.
Still, I can delete my data.
Yes, you can do it same. It's more on the context of WordPress or the application you are trying to do. Docker is not about WordPress. Docker is itself a tool to run any application you want. Yes. Yes, it's more about the Linux side and all the stuff.
Okay.
So it's not about WordPress.
For example, my one server having
in the Docker.
Okay, I want to migrate my website to another server which is not having the Docker. So can I
copy my whole website, make a zip, and directly migrate to another website? Is it okay, or some coding or some folder architecture will be affected if I go the Docker migration to the non-Docker migration?
So you can do it. But I would say it's not the best way to do it. There are ways to actually migrate to Docker. That's what I meant. It's not easy to get started. But once you complete the learning curve, Docker is the one you would always go over the VPS or the shared hosting.
What?
That's a, we can take it offline.
Okay.
That's a last question.
Okay.
Anyone else? Thanks.